Today, we're showing you what happens when Goose meets Kafka. I'm joined by two guests who built the Confluent MCP server that enables Goose, an open source AI agent, to interact with real-time Kafka data. That means developers can basically prompt Goose to analyze streaming events without even touching SQL or writing any integration code. So can you two introduce yourselves with your name and what you do?
So my name is Edward Baseman. I'm at Confluent as a partner innovation engineer, essentially sitting at the frontier of like the next gen of Confluent, trying to figure out ways that we could push the ecosystem forward.
Yeah, I'm Sean, and I'm Confluent's AI entrepreneur in residence. So usually that requires a little bit of explanation, but I think the easy way to think about it is I work on kind of all things AI across the organization.
So what is Apache Kafka? Like, I know what it is, but a lot of people may not know, like the typical layperson. What exactly do you all mean by data streaming? And try explaining it as if you were speaking to a five-year-old or someone who's never heard of this before.
A good way to explain this is through analogies. Say you wanted to build something with like Legos. You know, everybody loves Legos. So typically, if you didn't have any Legos, you would like drive to a store, you would buy maybe a big box of Legos, you come home, and then you would decide to build something and you kind of dig through this box and eventually assemble something. And now imagine if instead of going to the store, buying this box and sort of digging through that to build something, as the blocks are actually assembled at the Lego manufacturing plant, wherever that is, those were actually delivered in real time on like a conveyor belt to your house. Mm-hmm. And not just your house, but essentially every house that wants to build with Lego. And you just pick that block off the belt and add it to your build. That's essentially data streaming and what the technology of like Apache Kafka gives you is like a real-time feed of your data as it's actually happening with this huge, you know, ability to fan out to all these different services. And this was the technology that was originally invented at LinkedIn. And the reason that they came up with this technology was essentially LinkedIn was going through this huge growth spurt, you know, 15 years ago. And there just wasn't technology that existed to help them solve these problems of like these like kind of real-time streaming situations where, you know, I click on something, it's not like that click just goes to a database. It needs to go out to like thousands of different systems and ideally as fast as possible.
Okay, so now that folks understand what Apache Kafka is and what Confluent is, let's talk about the MCP server you built. What specific pain points does it solve?
In a lot of ways, we're not necessarily addressing pain points. We are providing new ways for you to interact with our system, right? So like pretty much the standard nowadays, if you're building a SaaS or you're building a product, is you expose a REST API, right? Essentially what we're doing here is we're exposing another interface, right? We're not doing a REST API this time. Now you're exposing it through like natural language. So you get to interact with our product and our systems using English, right? Or your favorite language, really.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's the beauty of MCP is it gives essentially a way to interface with APIs or data systems in a way that's like natural to agents. Whereas versus what was sort of historically natural to people who were programming, which is, you know, API interfaces. I think from, you know, maybe less of an MCP perspective, but from a data streaming perspective, I think we do sort of solve a fundamental pain point, which is really around if you're building these kind of AI experiences, there's, I would say the majority of use cases rely on access to fresh information. So, you know, many experiences essentially can't wait for the data to end up in static storage. For example, if I had some sort of like customer service co-pilot with United Airlines that helped me rebook a flight after a flight was been canceled, then I need that co-pilot to have access to things like my bookings, what booking, you know, what are available for flights coming up, what are the real-time events related to those flights, are they delayed, all these types of things. Like, if so, it's really a combination of sort of, you know, just in time, like in the moment information that you need to be able to make decisions, as well as historical data. Like you want to know what happened maybe 6 months ago, but I also want to know what happened 6 minutes ago. And most sort of ETL process down into a database, data warehouse, data lake are too slow essentially to solve that first problem of like what happened in the last 6 minutes. So that's kind of where you need real time as well as sort of historical data for most AI applications, especially AI agents, to do, you know, make reasonable decisions. Otherwise, they'll make bad decisions faster.
Okay, I will love to see this happening live.
To start things off, you may be curious to know what tools do you have access to. I've already kind of gone ahead and connected it to Bedrock and using my Claude model and all that kind of stuff. Boom. Okay. So we got a whole lot of stuff from different categories, topic management, Flink statements, connector management, and like just different things that can exist within our ecosystem, right? The very obvious first one that you may want to do is like, show me all the Kafka topics you got. One nice thing that I like to do when using Goose CLI is to run it in debug mode, because I like to see what's being fed to the server, as well as like the response.
Love that.
Right. So this is kind of like what's already connected to my server, a whole bunch of topics here. Let's take a look into some of the topics. Let's peek into there. I'm just like trying to like discover a little bit about like these topics, right? Because like, names can sometimes be ambiguous. Products, what kind of products are we talking about? That kind of thing, right? So really all I'm doing is I'm going to peek into it real quick over here, and the LLM will hopefully be able to digest this huge blob of like information and give me like a nice little summary of what's kind of going on.
I haven't used Apache Kafka, but just clarifying, as opposed to putting in natural language, you would have had to, if you weren't using Goose or another MCP client, you would have to like write a SQL query, I'm assuming, or?
Yeah, so there's multiple ways that you can kind of get data from Kafka. One is, you know, write some code, write a producer, write a consumer, that kind of detail under the hood.
The beauty, I think, of MCP is that as someone who's consuming this like MCP server, I don't necessarily need to know anything about how those APIs function.
We have like a whole bunch of these topics that we saw. They're a little bit ambiguous. And, you know, maybe I'm in an organization that is a little bit more sensitive and I want to know, you know, which of my topics can kind of be considered sensitive, which are my topics I should be treating very, very carefully because they contain like personally identifiable information. Right. So you can, what I'm going to kind of go over here next is, you know what, I'm going to sample some data from a couple other topics. Right. And then I'm going to ask the LLM, hey, like, can you help me like tag them appropriately? Right. I may have like different data protection rules. I may want to change the retention time. So I can kind of use this to help me first identify which topics have that sort of information, tag it accordingly, and then, you know, make it comply to my rules. So let's kind of do just that. I'm going to first get it to sample that data. Then I'm going to have it create those tags for us and apply it to the topics that have data. So it created that tag. My API key doesn't have permissions to, you know, to actually add the tag to the topic. That's fine. That would be a separate issue I would have solved by adding the permissions. For now, let's just try changing the retention time of that topic.
When I was doing a lot more sort of hands-on engineering, if you're these types of like infrastructure setups where you might do it, you kind of like set it once and forget it, and you figure out how to do it based on the documentation or tutorials or whatever. And then like a year goes by and you have to go and like make an update, and you know that the functionality is there, but you have no idea like where, like how you did it. Being able to just express sort of in natural language the thing that you want and then have that thing go off and actually execute it is like hugely, hugely beneficial, I think, when it comes to this like kind of once in a while configuration type of stuff.
So much time and stress saved.
Yeah. There's also like an operational aspect of it where like back when I put on my administrator hat, I had to expose a way for my developers to create like their own Kafka topics, right? And I didn't want to be the bottleneck. What's nice about it is that like, you know, instead of messaging me through Slack, you can kind of message this directly to create your topic that you need. It's pretty neat.
I have a follow-up questions for y'all on just like your opinions on the MCP ecosystem. I've seen a lot of engineers, I've even been on a couple podcasts where folks are kind of dismissing this idea of MCP because it's such early tooling and they're like, oh, it doesn't have this feature and that feature. But at the same time, I'm still seeing a really large growing ecosystem where multiple companies like GitHub and even Confluent are developing and coming out with their own MCP servers. I'm curious, what do you think is drawing people in despite the rough edges?
I mean, I think a lot of that has to do with standardization in anything is sort of a necessary thing to happen. Like if you look at any kind of standard like SMTP in like 1982, if you look at the world before SMTP existed, like email was a complete disaster zone. Like essentially you had a massive incompatible systems. There's no unified protocol, no inbox standards, no delivery guarantees. You basically send an email and then you had to call the person to ask, hey, Edward, did you get my email? Because there's no way to know whether that was like successful or not. So, and I think like when it comes to, you know, using tools inside an agent, you know, we're in a similar phase of this like chicken and duck wire kind of phase of like the growing pains of any kind of new way of developing things. So standardizations help like that with that. Now, there has been some attempts, I think, at standardization, you know, as early as OpenAI. But I think there was a couple of challenges with some of the early attempts was in part like the models just weren't ready. They weren't reliable in terms of being able to figure out which functions to call. And not all the models are as reliable as others. I think the newer models of GPT I've also had lots of success with, but there's other models that are not as good at this. So I think that for MCP in particular, it was kind of perfectly timed with the need that was growing in the industry in terms of like people are starting to build more agents. If you're doing three integrations, it's not that big a deal. But if you're doing hundreds of integrations, it starts to become like a burden. So they kind of read the tea leaves of where these problems were going to start. And we're able to time that to the pain point that people are starting to have, the growing interest in agents. And because also it was an open standard, a lot of people just started building with it versus some of these proprietary attempts previously. And I think like one of the big things that I feel like has really helped MCP in the last couple of months has been in the last like 1.5 to 2 months, OpenAI, AWS, Google, Microsoft all came out with support for MCP within their agent frameworks. So that is a, you know, all the sort of leaders in the industry are also promoting this. But ultimately, like standards live and die by the ecosystem of people who are supporting it. So you could have the best standard in the world, but if nobody uses it, like who cares? So it really comes down to use of that thing. And then of course, there's going to be growing pains. And even something that's as popular as MCP at the moment might not be the thing that ends up living on forever. It's hard to tell right now. And my advice like for businesses would be to pay attention to the standards. I'd probably lean into them, adopt them, but you have to architect in such a way that you're being adaptable because things could change. Like everything's changing so fast in the market. You can't wait for stabilization to essentially happen. You have to architect for adaptability.
Yeah. And I can kind of give like from the developer perspective over here, right? Like I understand the hesitancy of like trying something out that like will maybe die in a week or two or a month or whatever. But the reality is that within this ecosystem, right, you're either at the frontier, right, or you're not in it at all, right? So you got to play around with it. And honestly, for me, from like just from my perspective, nothing really clicked until I started using it and I started playing around with it myself. Right. The big aha moment for me was that, you know, by using this, right, I let go of like kind of the orchestration of things. I allowed this LLM to decide, you know what, it's time for me to do this, as opposed to me telling it, hey, do this, which was like a really cool aha moment. I know other protocols kind of support the same idea, right? But you just got to be taking the risk. I'm fully cool with, you know, if a new standard comes out and it turns out to be better and it turns out to be widely adopted, like I'm more than happy to pivot. It's just the ecosystem we live in. Don't be afraid.
Yeah, I think my thoughts are very aligned with yours, Sean. And then Edward, I really liked what you said about like, if like the way that this ecosystem is, like if you're not at the frontier, I don't know if I'm getting the quote right, but like if you're not adopting the newest thing, like you're behind. And I'm like, a lot of people don't understand that. So thank you so much for those thoughts, y'all. All right. And then my very last one for you all is, How do you think data streaming plays a bigger role in the future of agent architectures? Where does it fit into MCP as it evolves?
Yeah, so I mean, I think there's two major roles from my perspective around data streaming. The first one is sort of from an infrastructure standpoint. So if we think about what an agent is, so most people are not going to build monolithic agents where it's, you know, just one agent that's doing everything. You're probably going to decompose it into smaller sort of sub-agents, basically a multi-agent system. And, you know, if you remove sort of all the hype around what an agent is, I think from like an infrastructure standpoint, like how do you actually run and deploy one of these things? It has basically all the characteristics of a microservice. It's really just a microservice with a brain where it's using this LLM to do some decision making about which tools it's going to use, you know, how it's going to hand off messages and things like that. And all the challenges I think that you run into with building and scaling these systems are a lot closer to sort of typical engineering challenges around just running distributed systems than necessarily unique AI challenges. So a lot of this comes down to like your ability to run essentially a multi-agent system or a microservices architecture. And the way that people have historically done that at scale has been through event-driven architecture using technology like Kafka as essentially a way to decouple these systems so that rather than having a quadratic explosion of interdependencies with point-to-point connections, you essentially create a linear dependency where, you know, microservice A or essentially agent A doesn't need to know anything about the downstream consumers, essentially just producing consuming events. So I think using events as like the shared language and a technology like Kafka, Flink as the backbone for agent inter-agent communication makes a ton of sense to me.
Another way you can kind of sort of think about it, right, is that we're today, the ecosystem, we see things as, you know, my client, my little chatbot, right, talking to a server and then coming back, right? It's a human to server interaction, right? I would encourage folks to start entertaining what happens when you're doing service to service interactions. That's where data streaming plays like a large role, where you're now no longer relying on like myself sitting behind a little chat bot, waiting for a response, whatever. You have these systems that are like these agents, these microservices, that are self-reliant, that ask their own questions, that start responding to things, to events happening in the ecosystem around you, right? Temperature changes by 10 degrees. I kick off 10 other microservices that do this thing. It's like, it's pretty cool, right? And what we're really doing is you're just adding the tooling, right? This MCP server, these LLMs to these microservices, calling them agents and letting them operate on their own. Right. So I would encourage folks to start thinking of service to service communication, how Confluent and Kafka could play a role in that.
That's just thinking about agents just responding to the environment on their own and everything. That's kind of mind blowing to me. I can't wait for that. Thank you to our guests, Sean and Edward, for joining us and sharing such insights. I will end with a little note, just saying that like MCP is gaining traction and it's really exciting to see real-time data, agents, and open protocols coming together like this. If you want to try this out yourself, we've linked the Goose documentation and the Confluent MCP server below. Let us know what you build. And if you're into this kind of stuff, subscribe to our channel for more.